CoLab's purpose at the Constellation Fund is to invest in actionable research on poverty-fighting solutions. At CoLab, we hold population-level impact as our North Star. We believe strategic investments in research can help drive that level of impact by informing funding and policy. Even with programs and policies that have great anecdotes, we often have blind spots. Without good data, we can't really know the results for everyone who participates and whether some people benefit more than others. Often, programs exist and grow more because of their fundraising capacity than their demonstrated impact.
This is where CoLab comes in. CoLab invests in world-class research and programs impacts so that funders and people living in poverty can make better informed choices based on evidence of meaningful change in people's lives. One key type of research we support is called longitudinal impact evaluation.
Wait, can you unpack that?
Yeah, for sure. Let's start with impact evaluation. An impact evaluation assesses the effect that a program or policy has on specific outcomes. It challenges us to be clear about meaningful changes we hope to see in people's lives and examine whether a program or policy causes those changes.
But how do we know that those changes are caused by a program and not by something else, such as someone simply getting older, a changing economy, or supports coming from other sources? If people's outcomes don't improve during or after the program, how do we know that the program didn't prevent outcomes from getting worse?
So imagine I told you that 100 first-generation college students were selected to receive financial support and personalized coaching through a new program to support college completion. Then I told you that 60% of those students completed college, while the national average for first-generation college students to get their degree is only 26%.
Wow. Looks like that program improved college completion by 34 percentage points. Not bad.
But wait, what if I also told you that this program selected only the most motivated and high-achieving students to begin with, and it turns out that close to 60% of those students would have graduated college with or without the program support? Well, now you might be thinking differently about the poverty fighting impact of this program. This gets to one of the trickiest parts of conducting a credible impact evaluation. To answer these how do we know questions, researchers have to establish something called a counterfactual. A counterfactual is what would have happened if someone did not participate in the program.
Is that why researchers use secret time machines to evaluate programs?
Unfortunately, researchers haven't invented a time machine yet. So the best we can do without a time machine is to create a comparison group of people who do not participate in the program that is very similar to the people who do participate. And then we follow and compare the outcomes of both groups over the same time period.
So that way, the only difference between the two groups is participation in the program. And we know that any difference between the groups and changes to their outcomes reflects the true impact of the program.
Exactly. Now, ideally, for estimating the impact of a program, researchers create a comparison group by randomly assigning eligible people to the program group and to one or more comparison groups. We call this a randomized trial or experimental design.
Now imagine most programs do not have enough resources to serve all the people who could benefit anyways. So random assignment can provide a fair and transparent way to offer spaces or resources while allowing for a credible way to assess the program's impact.
That's right. But still, sometimes a randomized trial isn't feasible.
True. And in these cases, researchers can use other ways of creating a comparison group. These non-randomized approaches to creating comparison groups are called quasi-experimental designs. For example, researchers might statistically match people on different characteristics, such as income, education, race, or ethnicity. But this doesn't usually account for harder to measure differences between groups, like motivation.
So given that limitation, we're typically less sure about how we can attribute changes in outcomes to the program when we use quasi-experimental designs rather than randomized trials.
So what about the first part of this term, longitudinal?
So let's think long, or long term. Very few evaluations ever study the impact of programs on people's outcomes beyond even a year or two. For example, housing assistance might have short-term effects on families, housing stability, and well-being. Yet, that same stability could also help children stay in school, experience healthier development, and eventually attain higher levels of education and income as they transition into adulthood. When we commit to tracking long-term outcomes, we can show how those causal pathways unfold, and we can demonstrate a greater return on investment.
Unlike most research funding, CoLab invests in research that follows people's outcomes using surveys and data through public systems over many years, in some cases more than a decade, while sharing lessons along the way.
But there's more to the story than just numbers, right?
Of course. Often we need to know why programs do or don't have the impact we expect, or how we can make them as effective as possible. Process evaluation plays an important role alongside impact evaluation in answering these how and why questions. A process evaluation uses qualitative research and mixed methods to shed light on program implementation, how people experience the program, context, unintended consequences, and mechanisms for change. For example, imagine an impact evaluation of a cash assistance program providing $1,000 monthly with financial coaching to young adults who've been in foster care that aims to improve their long-term economic empowerment. Perhaps an impact evaluation shows a reduced employment rate after 2 years of participation for young people in the program.
Oof, that seems a bit concerning.
But now imagine that through in-depth qualitative interviews, program participants describe feeling more motivated and empowered than ever to pursue their goals. They explain how the cash assistance provided enough of a safety net for them to leave low-paying survival jobs and invest more time into education and skills development that supported their long-term career goals.
So this also illustrates how qualitative research can help justify and inform longitudinal data collection. Listening to people's experiences can help us shift our gaze from short-term results as endpoints to how programs help people get on long-term pathways to thriving.
Good point. But let's back up, Ruthven, just a little bit. Could you speak to how CoLab also makes strategic investments in mixed methods research, sometimes before we make impact evaluation investments?
Definitely. This type of upfront research is sometimes called market research, needs assessment, or formative evaluation, because it helps us form and inform solutions before we evaluate them. It involves collaboration among researchers, community members, and people with lived expertise to strengthen programs and inform evaluation priorities.
You see, as researchers and social scientists, we're trained early in our education and careers on the importance of minimizing and disclosing bias. That is, the results of our research should reflect the truth as much as possible, without distortion or prejudice. But often the biggest source of bias in research relates to the questions we choose to ask and the types of solutions we focus on in the first place. That's why CoLab's approach to funding research for impact starts and ends with listening to the people and communities most affected by the problems we're trying to solve.
That's right, Matt. And to those tuning in, a key takeaway from this nerdy conversation is that we can't end poverty in the dark. We hope you'll find ways to help us build and use actionable evidence as a guide and light for population-level impact.